Oh, hello again. So, as many of my viewers are probably aware, this year, 2013, represents the 150th anniversary of the Civil War. Well, the middle of the Civil War. But it also includes the Battle of Gettysburg, where the brave Union forces courageously defeated those traitorous rebel scum and drove them from the sacred borders of Pennsylvania. Why am I wearing a flag? Huh. 34 stars. Wonder where that came from. Anyway, so along with being the 150th anniversary of the Civil War, this year is also the bicentennial of the War of 1812, which spilled over into 1813 and 1814 and a couple of weeks of 1815. Point is, it's also the bicentennial of the War of 1812, which a lot of Americans don't remember. And in fact, a lot of the British who we fought in the war don't remember it either. And really, the only people who remember it is the Canadians. And I'm going to try to explain a little bit why about that, and hopefully you'll come away with a little bit better knowledge of history. So, why do we forget the War of 1812? Well, for the Americans, it was really embarrassing. If you're being generous, the War of 1812 was a draw for the Americans. But I'm willing to say we lost, considering Washington, D.C. was burned by British troops. That's pretty bad when your capital gets burned by the enemy. So, kind of a loss for us. The British don't really remember the War of 1812 because they had more important stuff going on in Europe. 1812 is the year that Napoleon gets defeated outside Moscow in Russia, and it's the fall of the Napoleonic Empire, which culminates in the battles of 1814, eventually Waterloo in 1815. So it's, you know, it's Britain remembers Napoleon. They don't really remember this provincial war that happens in the Americas, but is tied into the Napoleonic Wars. And just by the way, the 1812 Overture, which I played at the opening and I'll play during the credits, is actually celebrating Napoleon's defeat outside Moscow. It's in no way related to the War of 1812, so, but I like the song. I felt it was still kind of appropriate year-wise. So, what was happening was, as I mentioned, the Napoleonic Wars are still going on at full strength. Napoleon has almost absolute dominion of the continent, and Britain's fighting him, Russia's fighting him, Austria and Prussia are kind of gauging if they're going to get involved or not because they'd been beaten before. And Britain was trying to participate, well, trying to force a surrender by the French through economic blockade. And what this means is any ship going to French ports first had to stop with the British Navy and make sure they weren't carrying contraband or anything like that. So it was considered a violation of neutrality on the high seas, but Britain, being Britain with the largest navy in the world, is like, we don't care about neutrality of the high seas, we'll do whatever the hell we want. So, the Americans, this was an issue for the Americans, because American merchants obviously wanted to trade with both Britain and France. You know, sell to both sides, make tons of money, the American dream. And the British kept stopping American ships, which was really irritating for merchants because they can't trade with France. Britain's not letting them do what they want, and it feels like we're being bullied around by our old colonial masters. On top of this is the impressment of American sailors into the British Navy. Now, to understand, you have to understand that the British Navy sucked. Working in the British Navy as a sailor was awful. I mean, it was pretty good if you were an officer, and if you're, like, really high up there as an admiral, it was pretty prestigious. But as an ordinary sailor, it was the worst job imaginable. And part of this was because the British Navy tended to be, in some cases, up to 4 years late in paying the sailors. So, you know, if you're a British sailor, your family's starving because you haven't been paid in 4 years, so It's not good. And understandably, you don't have a lot of people lining up to volunteer for the British Navy. So what the British would do is they would go into port towns, which of course have lots of drunk people, with these press gangs, and they would find gentlemen who are not rather sober and take them onto their ship and impress them into service. And by the time the gentlemen have found themselves sober, they are out in the middle of the ocean, stuck on one of His Majesty's warships with no way of getting back. So it was not a pleasant practice, and a lot of people disliked it. And this extended to when British ships would board, British warships would board American merchant ships. If there was a sailor with a sort of British accent, it sounded like he came from Ireland or England or Scotland, they would say, well, he's probably an escapee from the British Navy, so we're gonna take him, and we're gonna take him on our ship, so good luck. And this was really offensive to the Americans because they saw it as a violation of their national sovereignty. So that led to America finally declaring war on Britain in 1812. The war itself has three major components. The first is a highly successful naval war against the British Navy, which is actually kind of surprising, and I'll explain a little bit more about that later. The second element is a very poorly planned invasion of Canada, which ultimately fails. And the third part is a very vicious and brutal war against Native Americans in what is now known as the South, which was kind of the American West at the time. So, in regards to the naval war, what happens is the Americans have a couple of small ships, small frigates like the USS Constitution, which is known as Old Ironsides, and they get into fights with other British ships. Now, obviously, they're not taking on the whole British Navy. That would not be possible because the British Navy is the largest navy in the world. It is the wooden walls of England. The Americans have a handful of ships. They could not take on the entire British Navy. But they have these small frigates which go out and they get into one-on-one fights with British frigates and they win. And it's really boosting for American morale because no one has beaten the British Navy before, so this is really surprising. Ultimately, this sort of campaign, it's a sideshow, really, because the war doesn't go, it doesn't have any effect on the war. The American Navy can never defeat the British Navy. They can be a nuisance at best. And so, while they can cause trouble for the British, ultimately the British Navy, when it focuses their resources, are capable of gaining control of the high seas and they can land redcoats wherever the hell they want. And that includes on the coast of Virginia and Maryland, where they ultimately burn Washington, D.C. in 1814. Just as an example. However, what is important, and this sort of ties into the naval war and leads to our invasion of Canada, is the Battle of Lake Erie, which is up in, well, it's technically happened now within my native state of Ohio. What happens is, to understand, the Americans have always kind of wanted to incorporate Canada into the states at this time. There had been an invasion of Canada during the Revolutionary War, and it didn't work out, so now the Americans are going to try to invade Canada and make it part of the United States again. And to do this, they need to have control of the Great Lakes, because the fastest way to transport anything at the time is by ship. You have to remember, there are no railroads, roads are pretty shitty, the fastest way you can move anything is by horse, and that's just by land. It's much easier to transport goods and lots of soldiers and cannons and ammunition and food and all that stuff by water. So, to launch this invasion of Canada, the Americans need to control the Great Lakes, which will enable them to cross over into Canada. The British, knowing this, also build a small fleet on Lake Erie. So, The Americans and the British are racing to finish their fleets before the other one on Lake Erie. Ultimately, to make a long story short, Commodore Perry of the Americans defeats the entire British fleet on Lake Erie, leaving the Americans uncontested control of the Great Lakes. And this is the only time an entire British fleet is defeated by an enemy force in combat. And so it's pretty significant, but it leaves the Americans capable of invading Canada at any time they want, while at the same time keeping the British from invading the United States because they don't have the supply lines necessary. This is important because the British at the time wanted to turn what is the current states of Ohio, Indiana, and Michigan kind of into a large reserve for Native Americans, because the Native American tribes were obviously being pushed out by white settlers in Ohio and Indiana and Michigan, and they wanted their land back, quite understandably. So the British, wanting to curb the expansion of the United States, offered the Native Americans, if they fought for them in the war, then they would give all this land in what was called the Northwest Territory to the Native American tribes. Obviously, that didn't work out. Now, the Americans attempted to invade Canada as well, and it just didn't work out. And there are a combination of reasons for this. Part of it is leadership. They were using generals from the American Revolution who were, you know, in their 60s now, and they're not as sharp as they used to be. They're using mostly militia, and the problem is militia are just not as well trained or equipped or disciplined as regular soldiers. And part of it is the British are better organized. They have the Redcoats, and then they have the Native Americans, and then they have local militias. And the local Canadian militias kind of fight harder than the American militias because the Americans are invading their home. And this is why, out of everyone involved, only the Canadians really remember the War of 1812, because it's when the big bad Americans came and invaded poor Canada. And you have to understand, Canada had, there's Quebec, which is French-speaking, and it was originally a French colony, but the British took it from the French and came under British control. And then you have English-speaking colonists and colonists from all over the place who come together, and in the War of 1812, they work together to fend off an American invasion, and it's seen as a unifying moment for Canada. And they successfully stall the American invasion. The Americans obviously don't get in. We'd never annex Canada, so it ended badly for the Americans. Finally, in regards to the vicious Indian wars in the South, Andrew Jackson is involved, and he also has regular soldiers, a small component of regular soldiers in addition to militia. To understand, regular soldiers, these are people who fight for a living. They are professional soldiers. They have uniforms, they have equipment, they have training. This is their job, and regular soldiers can be relied upon to follow orders and stay steady in combat and actually do the job. However, the Americans do not trust a standing army. Part of their complaints in the American Revolution was the abuses of the British standing army against American citizens. So they decided that they didn't trust a large standing army, so they kept the regular army fairly small. However, in any military force during the American Wars, the regular army provides an important nucleus around which any military force can be created. And so Andrew Jackson relies upon his regulars to assist in this prosecution of the campaign. Militias, which this is what the Americans wanted to protect the nation. They wanted a sort of citizen army where ordinary people who have jobs, who have things going on, who aren't professional soldiers, show up and they have weapons and they protect the nation from invaders. And in times of war, the militia can be called up for a short period of time to go and attack Native Americans or Canadians or British soldiers, whatever. The problem with the militia system is the militia They don't spend a lot of time training, obviously. They train, like, maybe once a month, if that. A lot of the time, it's just the guys hanging out, having a couple of beers, and talking. It's not really a formal training. And they elect their own officers. They don't follow orders. They can't be relied upon in combat. So, militias are not reliable soldiers for the Americans, and yet they use them as the majority of their military forces, which is part of the problem and why Americans fail in invading Canada. In the South, the Americans attacked the Indians. Now, the justification that they provided at the time was that the British were providing weapons to the Native Americans. And they might have been, but really, any historian will tell you now that the honest reason why the Americans attacked the Native Americans in the South was because they weren't white and they had land that the white people wanted. I'm sorry if that's blunt, but that's how it happened. So, the Andrew Jackson leading his militia volunteers and a component of the regular army succeed in they burn down villages and they kill people, and it's really sad. But he's lauded as a war hero because, I mean, racism being what it was in the early 19th century, the Indians are these evil people who are going to come and kill us all and rape our women and burn down our villages, so we should do it to them first. I don't really like talking about, but it happened, is what I'm saying. So, and it's not really related to the rest of the war, but there you go. Eventually, now we kind of fought to stalemate. I say the United States was kind of losing because obviously Washington, D.C. got burned down, none of our war goals were achieved. The problem the Americans faced was in 1814, British and other allied forces like the Russians and the Austrians were soundly defeating Napoleon. Paris was taken, Napoleon was exiled, and it looked like the British were going to be able to focus their full resources on the United States. Part of the reason why the War of 1812 didn't get bigger than it did was because Britain was busy fighting Napoleon at the time. A conflict in the Americas, it's not a big deal. They send a couple of regiments and they rely on local militia, but it's not going to be their major concern. They're worried about Napoleon. But with Napoleon gone, now the full force of the British Army and the British Navy can come to attack the United States. However, at the same time, the reason why the United States and the British were fighting, which was this issue caused by the British blockade of Napoleon, is gone. Napoleon is gone. The British don't care about keeping anyone from trading with Napoleon. So now there's no reason to keep fighting. So there had been some negotiations, and ultimately everything went back to the state before it was the war. Canada stayed in British hands, Ohio and Michigan stayed in American hands. Everyone agreed to not have armed ships on the Great Lakes. It was basically a waste of time in many respects, which, a lot of wars are sometimes. There is a final event which is sort of important, and it was kind of an overtime event. Andrew Jackson had a very resounding victory at New Orleans, the Battle of New Orleans. There's obviously a song about it. And what happened was Andrew Jackson set up a basically trench system with defenses which kept the British from advancing. He had regular soldiers forming a key part of his military forces, as well as a unit of artillery from the regular army, which was capable of defeating the British, and they lost. So it was seen as this huge victory for the Americans. However, it happens in the first few weeks of 1815 The Treaty of Ghent, which ended the War of 1812, was signed in December of 1814, so the war was already over, but, you know, it takes 3 months to communicate across the Atlantic, so they didn't know. But it's seen as this huge victory, and Andrew Jackson eventually gets elected with this reputation as a great war hero. But America pretty quickly forgot the War of 1812, because there weren't, as much as I like to say the Americans lost, there weren't really clear winners, there weren't really clear losers, and America didn't really accomplish anything. So it's very quickly forgotten, despite the fact that we have Andrew Jackson and the Battle of New Orleans, and even the Star-Spangled Banner is from the War of 1812 with the Siege of Fort McHenry. And so, sort of critical components of American nationalism are born in the War of 1812, which extends to the era of good feelings afterwards in the early 1810, or late 1810s to the 1820s. And so, as a result, American nationalism is born in the War of 1812, despite the fact we don't remember it. And it's also important to remember the Americans kind of reanalyze how they do things. They realize that a well-trained officer corps is necessary for the prosecution of war, and they're going to need more regular soldiers. And this is what happens in the Mexican-American War in 1846, is that we have this corps of well-trained officers from West Point who successfully prosecute the war and lead to a resounding American victory. So, the War of 1812 is important in that it leads to later things, but many people forget it because, in many ways, it didn't change anything as politically or on the large scale. There were a lot of smaller changes, which you see over time, but immediately there was no apparent change, and it felt really pointless. So, hopefully I have provided some good information for you, and if you're interested, do some more reading about it. As I said, it's kind of, you know, a slap fight between the United States and Britain that doesn't have a lot of significance for the Americans or the British. And, of course, my Canadian friends are like, yeah, we beat you Americans the only time you got beaten, except for Vietnam and Bay of Pigs and maybe a couple other times. But, yeah, we beat you. So, obviously, for my Canadian viewers, this is, you know all this, and you're celebrating. You probably know all the names of the generals and stuff. But feel free to investigate. Always learn more stuff. And if anyone ever says that America never fought a war with imperialist gains in mind, that's simply not true. I mean, it's more overt in the Mexican-American War and the Spanish-American War, but 1812, trying to conquer Canada, yeah, that's kind of imperialist. So just keep that in mind.